So, how long have you been a band? What's the origins of the band? How did you come up with the name? And, like, what was your idea when you started the band?
My band, as you can call it, you know, my train wreck with the name, Eviscerated Zombie Tampon, was formed in the summer of 2003. My friend Scott Valentino, who's no longer with us, and I were, I threw a barbecue back in July 2003. I just moved into a new place. I decided I was going to throw the most epic barbecue Brandon had ever seen. I had a bunch of people coming over. And I had a few beers, Scott was drinking a few, and we were talking about forming a band. Now, we weren't letting the fact that neither of us could play an instrument hold us back. You know, this wasn't going to happen. We also felt that we wanted to go ahead and kind of lightly poke fun of the scene, because at that time it had gotten really pompous. You had a lot of pseudo rock stars, big fish, small pond type thing. You know, I am this, I'm great, I'm wonderful. And, you know, every song they played, it was like they were curing cancer. And it's like, dude, you're in a death metal band. Seriously, come on. But whatever. So we wanted to poke fun at all of that. Kind of like how punk started, you know, it's deflating prog rock. It was the same concept. So we decided, well, neither of us could play an instrument, so we'll both be vocalists. And we know a lot of musicians, so I'm sure we'll find at least somebody that can go ahead and play. And if not, who cares? We'll still, you know, if you have a guitar, you can be our guitarist type of mentality. The name was almost freeform. We were just throwing out different things, including, I still remember one name, the Alternative Cheese Combo, which I thought was a great name, but it just didn't, it seemed metal enough. Then I remembered good old Dimmu Borgir with their, let's put three words together that mean absolutely nothing and we'll call it an album title. So we did the same thing, only we're going to do it for our band name. So we just started throwing out stupid names, stupid words. Eviscerated Zombie Tampon came out. We looked at each other. It was gold, and so be it. So that was in the summer of 2003. Well, in September of 2003, I was putting on a metal festival over at the Pegasus Lounge because I had illusions of grandeur and thought I could go ahead and put on a big festival by myself. Because, hey, you know, I'm Splattergod. I got a store. I could do anything. So it was about that time I hooked up with my now wife, Susan. And she went ahead and supported me with that, so that was cool. She was helping me along. Well, we decided we were going to go ahead and debut EZT at this thing, because if you can't go ahead and use the fact that you're putting on a festival to promote your own band, then what good is it? We decided we were going to do it early, because I didn't want to be one of those assholes and say, well, it's my festival, I'm going to take the best slot. So we decided we were going to put, the fest started at 12 noon. And it went on till like 3 in the morning. It was 16 bands for $5, which I thought was more than fair. Managed to get Unholy Ghost to headline it. So, you know, hey, you know, that was pretty freaking cool. And we had bands from all over the place. A lot of bands that had never played Tampa or hadn't played in a long time. And Pegasus was, at that time, still had the bad rep of being a biker bar. So they couldn't get any metal shows there. And when Julie had me and this guy Ryan Michalski booking for her, she knew I was had a pulse of the metal scene. And she was like, can you get Cannibal Corpse or Morbid Angel? And I'm like, are you shitting me? Your club's the size of a shoebox. But I can get some metal bands in here. Let me put on a festival that'll let people know that their band, you know, the bands are welcome here. There's a metal scene here. You're metal friendly, and that will help. And of course, you know, if you look at the Pegasus, they're doing quite well with the metal bands now. So yeah, but we were the guys that did it. So anyway, getting back to that, we decided we're going to go ahead and debut that. The original lineup came about because first person I talked to was Ern from Vomit Spawn. He's a vocalist of Vomit Spawn, done some other stuff. You know, he was infamous around Tampa as being an over-opinionated asshole, but a really cool guy. And we kind of like, hey, Ern, you know, what do you think of this? He was all for it. And he's like, well, what can I do in it? You know, because he didn't want to do vocals. And I understood that because that's, you know, that's all he's ever done. So we made him our bassist because he didn't know how to play an instrument. So it just made sense. Then at that time, I was also doing a lot of work with Dark Faith. I went ahead and put out that split Dark Faith and Past Possessions first official release and everything on my label. And so Pete was initially going to go ahead and join up, and he was going to go ahead and play some guitar with EZT. Josh Jetty, who was the drummer for Vomit Spawn, was going to go ahead and do drums. And so it's like, okay, we're all set. This is what we're going to do. Now, the concept of EZT was going to be totally improv. We weren't going to practice. We weren't going to rehearse. We weren't going to write songs. We were going to get up there, play shit. I was going to sing about whatever I wanted. Scott was going to sing about whatever he wanted. Occasionally, we might ever sing the same song at the same time and just have a grand old time. Again, it was taking back the whole... It was too pompous, so we wanted to get as raw as possible. It was, we dubbed ourselves anti-music because it's pretty much what it was. We wanted a wall of sound. It was almost like if you took experimental noise artists like Masana, gave him a guitar, and stood him in front of a group and said, play a rock song, that's what we wanted to put out. So it was like 3:15, day of the show and everything. We're supposed to be getting on stage. Pete never showed up because he decided he didn't want to do it. Josh was too drunk. So, yeah. So I got my friend Ryan Mikowski, who also was in Space King, and he does Dead Dark Side. Now he's in a group called Cosmic Punch, which is kind of like a Britpop, which they're really good. So, you know, check them out. You know, Cosmic Punch is really good. That's Ryan and Punchy Gonzalez, you know, who played in Diet of Worms, and he produced, you know, did a lot of recording of Morbid Angel stuff and everything.
Diabolic.
Yeah, exactly. Punchy also was in Dead Dark Slide. Dead Dark Slide was a strange pseudo goth band, very weird, very outsiderish, but it kind of, they also played this metal fest. But anyway, so Ryan filled in on guitar. Susan, who had never played any instrument, who was originally just going to be, you know, thrown on keyboards just to keep her out of the way, she ended up drumming, which was kind of awesome. She just beat the living shit out of that kit. But afterwards, it was awesome. People were coming up to her, like high-fiving her for blast beats, and she's like, I don't know what the fuck I was doing. So, but Ern was nice enough to actually show up. He stole some kind of mechanics uniform, and he had a gas mask on. And we played an 18-minute set. Pretty much we played as long as Susan could hold out. She pretty much collapsed on the drum kit. Because Josh didn't show up, we borrowed Byam Kovar's drum kit. And if anybody remembers Byam Kovar, they were like this low-budget Lord of the Rings metal band. You had a bunch of kids, you know, 16 to 19 years old, that would dress up in cheap Lord of the Rings costume and play some symphonic black metal. They were actually a pretty good band. And everything. I don't know what the hell happened to them. But I do remember they held up the whole Metal Fest because they were doing a photo shoot behind the friggin' Pegasus. And the best thing is, Fark.com, one of those sites that like making fun of everything, actually got a hold of their picture and did a contest and had everybody making fun of that picture that came from that photo shoot. That was great. So Susan borrowed that. We hooked up my keyboard because I decided I was going to sing and run back and hit the keyboard a couple of times. Well, it got stuck in a loop, so I kept playing the demo. So you had do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do-do. Yeah, so it was like techno shit going on, so I had to unplug that crap. And we just started, and we just, and it was hilariously awful. I mean, I'm just, you know, Scott's doing the gutter, and we're making up stupid song titles as we go along, and we figured if we got out with our lives, it was going to be a good show. Little did we know, people dug it. People were applauding, they were hooping and hollering. I don't know if it was the beer talking or what, but people dug that stupid shit. We had a grand time rolling all over the place. Ended up stage diving on top of me at the end of the show. It was just a good time. At that show, Basshead and Pazuzu, who used to do a radio show in town, I'm trying to remember the name of it.
Cacophony.
Thank you. Cacophony Radio happened to be there. This inspired them to start their obnoxiously bad noise rock band called Raping Babies. More of that later. But, yeah, it just went off. People dug that and everything else. It was a grand old time, and it was supposed to be a one-off thing, and lo and behold, people came up, kept on, when are you going to do another show, when are you going to do another show, and then we did another show, and we did a few shows. We ended up calling it a day around 2005, 2006, that was about the time I closed my store, and I moved to New York for a while. We called it a day. In 2013, I was approached by a friend of mine that I'd known for a number of years, Xerxes, who had a group, Necrophalic, and he also had Fetus Omelet, asking me if I would reform it, you know, I'll play guitar type thing. And he kept pushing me. I mean, he'd been pushing me for almost a year. And finally, I contacted Scott, and it's like, hey, dude, you want to do this shit again? And he's like, you know what? Let's do it. So we were planning a tour and everything for it, and this was... We made the decision in March of 2013, and we were actually going to go ahead and lay out a small mini tour and everything, and then April 2nd, 2013, Scott was killed in a car accident. And imagine, you know, that was pretty fucking devastating. I'm still trying to come to terms with that. That was pretty much it for me. I was done. I wasn't going to do EZT until his widow and his family encouraged me to continue it on and everything. So I went ahead and continued it on, you know, and every show's in Scott's memory and everything else, because, you know, it was him and I from the beginning. So it's kind of weird to going out there now and not having him barking like a dog, but, you know. And that's kind of like a thumbnail sketch of Eviscerated Zombie Tampon.
How did you get into punk rock music?
Oh shit, dude. I like telling people, I'm older than heavy metal and punk rock, so it's kind of like I grew into that shit. Growing up in Orlando, Florida, I mean, I spent enough time in Tampa once I got wheels, but I grew up actually in Orlando. And Orlando was a little different than Tampa. It was much more of a hodgepodge. You really had all kinds of shit going on at one time, and I knew a lot of older kids in my neighborhood where I grew up. I mean, I grew up around a lot of hippies and rockers and everything else, so I was introduced to music when I was still in my single digits. I mean, hell, I was smoked up by some hippie when I was 9 years old, so yeah, Mom, 9 years old, your son's smoking the reefer. But seriously, so, I mean, I was always turned on to stuff. I used to hit everybody's garage sale, and I'd buy albums just based on their cover. Because when you're a little kid, that's all you got to go by, you know, either that or the radio. And my radio consisted of hearing my dad every 15 minutes saying, turn that shit down! So, you know, so I always knew it had to be good music if he didn't like it, because he only listened to country. So, some of the first bands I discovered were, you know, the Sex Pistols. And, you know, me being so young, I didn't even know what their name meant. Yeah, I found out later, you know, oh, okay, it's a euphemism for a dick. Okay, got you. But back then, I didn't know. I didn't even know what sex was. I mean, Christ, I'm not, you know, I'm just, pistols, it must be guns, they must be good, you know, but stuff like that. And, you know, I discovered it by buying records from garage sales and everything and talking to my friends and going to school, because I was so open to music. I didn't even understand what a music genre was until I got to junior high. That's how open-minded I was. I mean, my mom was pretty eclectic. She would let me rob her album collection, and she had everything from Alice Cooper and the Rolling Stones to Donna Fargo and Elvis and Tom Jones. So I just grew up listening to freaking music and everything. And I think that really benefited me, because I mean, when I got older, yeah, a lot of my friends were like, you listen to that shit? It's like, fuck yeah, it's good. And and they accepted me. I was one of those rare people that was accepted regardless of what I listened to, because I didn't give a fuck. I can't believe you listen to that. Well, I can't believe you don't. You know, I don't give a shit. You know, you suck. No, I don't suck. You suck because you're a close-minded jackalope and I'm digging some great music. So whatever. I mean, I really embraced new wave even as much as I embraced punk because, again, that was my era. And stuff, anything from Blondie to Susie Sue. Oh, my God. I had a crush on Debbie Harry and Susie Sue like there was nobody's freaking business. This little kid went through puberty listening and watching that shit. But, yeah, I mean, and I discovered, you know, a lot of the New York bands, like, you know, the Misfits, of course, because of the whole image type thing. And Ramones, I dug. They were kind of like a throwback. It's like, what happens when you take a 50s band and get crunchy guitars? And that's what I saw them as. I mean, this is a band that could tour with friggin' the Platters or something and just kind of rock it out. So I dug that, and I dug, you know, started digging a little deeper. I mean, back then, we didn't have an internet or whatever. It was all word of mouth. They sure as fuck wasn't playing this crap on the radio. So it was just pretty much whoever you made friends with. And I made friends with everybody. I was friends with the punkers and the jocks and the country folk and the jazz snobs and everybody. So, I mean, I grew up listening to Zappa, listening to Miles Davis, listening to Boyz II Cult, listening to Pink Floyd, listening to Dylan, listening to Ozzy. I didn't care. Yeah, I was the only male in school that would admit, yeah, I dig the Culture Club. Fuck yeah, Boy George rocks. I didn't care because I thought it was cool. Yeah, he was weird and everything to this redneck country kid growing up, but at the same time, I dug the fact that he was weird because he just didn't give a shit. He was being true to himself, so how could you hate a person that was being open and honest? I'd rather have someone like that than some pretentious jackass that's, you know, being a jerk about it. So yeah, I like that goofy pop shit and everything. Frankie Goes to Hollywood was fucking huge when I was in school, so yeah, relax. When I first time I saw the unedited video of Relax, I needed a shower. That thing was that was pretty raunchy, but I dug it. Soft Cell was another band that I really, really got into. Of course, you know, the Flock of Seagulls and Men Without Hats. I mean, that was all my era. I graduated in 84. So, I mean, you know, from the Knack on, you know, the whole new wave, you know, punk wasn't on the radio, so that was much more underground, but I was still checking out and digging it. And then when the first time I heard Black Flag, I was less like, holy fucking crap, what the hell is this? This is like fucking incredible. And that got me looking at the whole fucking Orange County shit, you know, I mean, just the all that Southern California stuff and just going, this is fucking amazing. And then Agent Orange, you know, you got surf music and punk together. Holy crap, this guy's a friggin' genius. And every Dead Kennedys, how can you not like Jello? God damn, I mean, yeah, so, I mean, I learned about Dead Kennedys because of the friggin' poster, of all things. You know, it's like, any band is getting all kinds of heat from the government because of a poster. Fuck yeah, I'm gonna like that band. But, you know I'm gonna like that band. Then I discovered Flipper, and Flipper was almost like a mind-altering experience for me because there was just so much talent in that group. And that was another group, just didn't give a fuck. They played whatever the hell they wanted, and I dug that. And then Violent Femmes, you know. The Fix is probably one of my favorite New Wave bands of all times. I think they're bigger than New Wave. They were just, there was so much talent in them. I still, to this day, jam to The Fix all the time. I discovered the Go-Go's before they became MTV darlings through tape trading. So the first time I heard Our Lips Are Sealed, and we got the beat, I was tripping because it was so much more radio friendly than that crunchy guitar shit I was hearing back in the day. But I still dug it. I mean, you know, I was just absolutely enamored with those girls. I mean, it was funny because that was when MTV was still in its infancy, and I'd be in my room and I hear my sister yell, Go-Go's are on, and I'd be like sprinting out of my freaking room, just dog freaking the fuck out, and you know, just planted in front of there, just staring, going, I want you. So yeah, they kind of, you know, Go-Go's, Debbie Harry, Susie Sue, yeah, they got me through puberty.
What is the coolest thing about playing in a band?
From my standpoint, to be honest with you, I grew up loving music. Music was always my number one thing above everything else. You know, above dating, above working, above anything. Music was my one constant. You know, I always saw music as my wife, and whoever I was dating was my mistress. You don't like my music? Piss off. You know, I don't care. I mean, you know, but I spent thousands upon thousands of dollars and hours going to shows. When I finally started doing it, it was so, yeah, it was just almost life-affirming for me, for lack of better. The first time I ever stepped on the Brass Mug stage, I got chills because I'd seen so many bands that I just loved on that stage. And the idea of me standing on that same stage and all these incredible bands is just, to this day, just touches me because it was just absolutely amazing. It's freeing. It's just awesome. You know, I understood so much more why people do it.
Let's try this again. Okay, what is the coolest thing about playing in a band?
Well, you can edit the other shit in there. It is freeing. I mean, it was just, when I first started doing it, it was just me and a group of friends having a grand time. And I realized that's the secret to having a band. And as soon as it becomes stressful, work, problematic, why fucking bother? Yeah, the Ramones were able to do it, even though Joey and Johnny hated each other. But that's the exception, not the rule. To me, it should be, you don't have to hang with each other 24/7, but you should at least enjoy each other's company. You should at least want to be around each other. You should at least think the other person doesn't totally suck balls. And that's what I loved about it. It was the idea of being on stage with friends, playing shows with other bands that were friends, and number one thing is looking out and seeing people smiling. That's all I give a shit about. I don't care. I'm always shocked, to this day, I'm always shocked when a bar owner hands me money. I haven't gotten wrapped my head around that. Because that's not why I do it. I mean, sure, it always amazes me because my band, like I said, is a train wreck with the soundtrack. But people dig it and we make money, so more power to you. But if I see people smiling out there, I've done something. I've made their day a little bit better. I don't know what's happened to them. Maybe they lost their job that day. Maybe their girlfriend, boyfriend, or whatever cheated on them. You know, whatever. You know, maybe they just stubbed their toe or their cat ran away. But they're smiling. That means I affected them positively. I gave them a little bit of reprieve from whatever mundane bullshit they're having to deal with. And that, to me, is the biggest payoff at all. So I love that. And the idea of, I always like to quote Corey from Living Color. The band Living Color, because I absolutely loved them and I loved his whole thing. He's like, where else can you be a madman shaking your ass at people and get paid? And I just appreciated that attitude, but it's true. You know, you get to have fun, you get to go ahead, and our band is just, we're button pushers, but we always do it with a smile on our face. We're not really trying to offend people as much as just poke fun at everything. Initially, when we started, our whole mantra was hold nothing sacred, because that's it. You know, we don't purposely try to offend people and everything, but at the same time, we're not going to sit there and go ahead, oh, we're PC. The hell with that. We're a band called Eviscerated Zombie Tampon. Already we're not PC. We have clubs refusing to play us because of our name. And it's like, if you're offended by tampons, you must have a hell of a time shopping. You know, you walk down the aisle of Walmart, there's tampons there. What the hell are you offended by? But they are, so whatever. But yeah, that's exactly, I mean, that's why I keep doing it, because it's just fun. I mean, when I did this recent tour and everything, it was just, it was wonderful. It was great. It was a bunch of people having a good time, a bunch of friends, and it was a good time, and I really dug it. So it was like almost like a brotherhood. Yeah, there were bumps in the roads, but that's with anything. But all things considered, it was a good time. That's what I get out of it.
What's the worst thing about playing in a band?
RSS. Rockstar Syndrome. So when you get some jackalope that all of a sudden thinks they're friggin' Elvis. and they start acting the fool. Whether they're macking on the bartender or strutting around, or they can't be bothered bringing their guitar into a club, or whatever crap's going on, you know, sleeping while the other bands are playing, you know, that kind of shit. That's what irks me, because I find that insulting. If I'm playing with other bands, I'm going to check them out. I don't care if I don't like them. I'm going to at least go out there and make my presence known and support them. I think that's the biggest problem in the scene right now is there's too much competition. Everybody wants to be a rock star, but nobody wants to support anybody else. And it's just like, no, you got to invest. If you want your scene to support you, you got to support the scene. You can't, well, I formed a band and I wrote a song. Why aren't I fucking famous? Because you're a dick. Because you don't go to shows unless you're fucking playing. And even if you are fucking playing, you're not going to shows. You're sitting outside getting shit-faced, coming in, playing your 30-minute set, and then going out and getting shit-faced. That's why you're not famous, because you're a dick. And that, to me, is the worst thing. I started calling it RSS probably back in around the 90s. And that, to me, is a perfect thing, because it really is. And you could tell the people right away, the way they carry themselves, the way they act, on wonderful. No, you're a dick. I don't care who you are. I don't care if you're fucking goddamn Yngwie Malmsteen. If you're fucking acting like that, you're a dick. Fucking pull it together, because I'm sorry. I don't care how good your band is. You're still in a fucking band. You're playing music. You're not curing cancer. You're not putting out forest fires. You're not fucking fighting wars. You're playing in a fucking band. Reel it in.
What's your most memorable show?
My most memorable. Oh yeah, to this point so far, EZT versus Raping Babies, January 31st, 2004, at the now defunct Club Venom. What had happened is after EZT played that show in September 2003, again, that was supposed to be a one-off show. Okay, we're done. That was fun. That was great. That was stupid. We were contacted in late December by Cacophony. They were doing some kind of benefit. Can't remember if it was for the station or Club Venom. I just knew they were doing a benefit. That was on January 10th of 2014. And they asked us if we would go ahead and play. And it's like, well, okay. Because I was confused. Anybody wanted to hear us again? I figured we'd just pissed everyone off and scared the shit out of them. But they want, okay, so we'll do it. So we went out there and we did the benefit. It was a fun time. We had a good time. And I think that was the one we had Ben from Cystic Dysentery. We always had a revolving guitarist because nobody seemed to ever want to play guitar with us. Whatever. Plus we had this other guy, and I feel so bad I can't remember his name. Chris. Can't remember his last name, Chris. He was not a musician at all. He was just a mutual friend of ours and Darkface and everything. And he was awesome when he played guitar, because he'd wear big bracers and everything and just rub them against the guitar and everything. So it just makes it, you know, kind of drill noise. Yeah, Eddie Van Halen, eat your fucking heart out. Type of shit. But the show went off real good and everything. It was a fun time, and we were asked before we left if we wanted to play the 31st there. Club Venom could not afford to stay open. The 31st was going to be their last day of being a club. Now, Club Venom was a really cool club. I mean, they had two stages there. It was obvious it was like a converted strip club. But, you know, personally, I think they did what a lot of these new clubs do. They get that nice little a bit of a loan in the beginning, and they piss it all away instead of planning out. They pay too much. And they did. They booked some bands, and they paid an assload of fucking guarantees for bands that really didn't deserve that shit. And I'm not going to name names because I'm not trying to piss people off. But let me just say, if you are a Tampa band, you should not be charging the same guarantee that you would in fucking Kalamazoo. You're fucking local. You're loading up in your goddamn car and driving down the fucking street. Give these clubs a fucking break, you dickheads. Okay, back to our regular report. Okay, so we decided, and I asked the club, I said, mind if we get a little crazy? And they made a mistake. They looked at me, he's like, Keith, you do whatever the hell you want. Yeehaw! So we started planning this epic thing. Now, the concept of the show, by the way, was EZT and Pazuzu and Basshead, the guys from Cacophony's group, raping babies, because they had to come up with a name more offensive than us. We're going to play a concert war. How it was supposed to be was they were going to start the set, we were going to come on stage, play, both bands are going to play together, and then they're going to get the fuck off and we're going to finish up the set. Sounded great. You know, now you have grind bands doing that shit all the time, doing grind wars, two bands on the same time playing. That shit wasn't happening when we did it. Not toot my own horn, but we were pioneers. So you had two bands that were noisy, offensive, and could barely play, going to be on stage at the same time. Now, Pazuzu and I had a friendly little rivalry going. We were going to one-up each other, so we were coming up with all kinds of crazy shit we were going to do. Hey, it was the last day. This club was closing. All bets were off, and it was. Well, the day of the show, they started, they opened up, they brought some guy to be a clown who went over absolutely horribly. Everybody thought he sucked. Then they started playing their music. Well, you know, people are kind of looking at him. Well, Earn and his drunken glories up front just keep screaming, "You guys fucking suck! Fuck you! We want EZT! You guys fucking suck!" Well, after a couple of songs, Pazuzu's like, "Fuck it! EZT, get up here." Well, Pazuzu was in his normal costume with his little floppy hat and everything. He called himself, what was his stage name? Pepe the Sodomizer. Good name, but I was Sir Necro Cunt Splitter. Yeah! So, anyway, so nobody, you know, they were used to it. The first show that we did, I was wearing a corpse-painted NSYNC shirt and a ski cap. The second show we did, I had a real long dread wig and a tank top. They didn't know what I was going to do. I came out as Jesus with a strap on.
Nice.
Big ass strap on. Yeah, well hung Messiah. We brought out an altar boy. We had a nun. Susan was dressed in a teddy. We had Scott, who was Pussy Maggot Bootylicious, was dressed as a 6 foot tall Oompa Loompa. Josh was wearing the mask, Michael Myers Halloween mask. And Chris was a bath from Immortal in a brown robe with a rainbow wig. Well, we came out, you heard the crowd just go, "Holy shit," and then we started. First thing we did is I got the altar boy and face fucked it on stage, ripped its head off and threw that into the crowd. Well, that started people starting to throw shit. Susan got an axe, chopped up the nun. Music starts blaring, people went ape shit. You got chairs flying, furniture breaking, stuff being thrown all over the place. Pazuzu was squirting the crowd with a super soaker filled with rancid buttermilk. I had a huge bag filled of rotten fish. I had bought a bunch of fish from the supermarket, buried it in my backyard for like 2 weeks and dug it out before the show. I brought bags of garbage, was throwing that out. I'm pelting people with fish. Hey, you know, Jesus, fish, the loaf, yeah, it was working. We're singing all kinds of stuff. It's all kinds of noise, stuff flying, things breaking and everything. Raping babies wouldn't get off the stage, so we just ended up, and then the show was over, and it was done. People wanted us to come back. We said, fuck it. Come to find out, there was like over $2,000 worth of damage to the club.
Oh, shit.
People were covered in God knows what. People were throwing up all over the place because Pazuzu squirted a few of them in the face with the buttermilk. I was nailing them with the fish. The queue to the bathroom was like a mile long of people trying to get cleaned up. The whole floor was covered in God knows what. It looked like a fucking war zone there. Monitors were broken. Furniture was broken. Mics were broken. A keyboard was soaked. Pretty memorable show. And guess what, folks? It's on YouTube. That's right. The video of the entire show is on YouTube. Look for that bad boy.
What are your goals as a band?
Not to get arrested. We're slowly starting to transition. When we first started our band, it was purely noise. It was, you know, let's make a wall of noise and be as offensive as humanly possible. Well, one of the reasons I stopped doing the band was it was getting to be a one-trick pony. People knew what to expect, crowds weren't getting that big, and everything else. So we started kind of shifting a little bit, getting a little more, getting some grooves going on, some breakdowns. When we restarted the band, Xerxes volunteered to be a guitarist. Well, he can actually play guitar. So right there, it was different than the way we were before. Then we got this one guy on drums, Randy, who is my drummer now, and incredible drummer, really is, friendly guy, laid back motherfucker. And next thing you know, I've got an actual real band that can really play. But I don't want to go ahead and be like every other fucking band either, because we're going to fall through the cracks. So we're doing a little bit of both. So it's about a two-thirds noise still, or at least improv, and then one-third of actually written kind of songs and everything. And I pretty much, I can't read or write music, but that's never stopped me. Because when I, you know, I found out like bands like Pink Floyd and everything started, they couldn't read or write music either. And McCartney couldn't read or write music either. And it's like, well, shit, what the hell am I afraid of? So I went ahead and I would write the lyrics, and I would go ahead and hum the friggin' melodies to the band members, and then they go ahead and play it along and everything. And so now we actually got some basic songs going, and we're actually going to, we've released 5 CDs so far, and they're all live. We've never released a studio CD yet, and so we are in the process. So that is this year coming up. We're actually going to be recording and releasing our first studio CD with some of our quote-unquote songs, including our staple song. We have one song that people like. Well, they like a few of our songs, but this one song in particular. I fucked my neighbor's cat just to see the expression on its face. People love that song. They dance to that song. Women rush to stay. Why do women like our music? I don't understand. I don't, but yeah, hey, more power to us. But yeah, that's pretty much, we see our band is kind of progressing. I look at Anal Cunt. They were kind of the same way. They were a really blur noise in the beginning. And as they went on, they became a little more punkish. They still maintain that, but at the same time, some of their songs you could actually follow and play and everything. And that's kind of where my inspiration is too. Is sometimes you got to grow and transition as long as you're still true to yourself. And you know, it's not like I'm chasing, you know, radio airplay or trying to sell records or whatever. It's more so, I just don't want to be a one-trick pony anymore. It gets boring. So I want to do at least a little bit of something. I have toyed around with forming another band as more of an outlet for my more melodic stuff or more musical stuff. And that's still up in the air, but, you know, it may happen, folks. It's going to be called Tinfoil Hat. Because I figured Twat Waffle was too offensive.
Do you make money or lose money playing in a band?
Lose money! Because I'm the motherfucker that goes ahead and pays for all the merch. I'm the motherfucker that pays for all the gas. I'm the motherfucker that does... You know, when we did this tour, you know, I got... You know, it was so hilarious because I hear, "Ooh, I'm not making any money." It's like, motherfucker, I lost $2,500 on that tour. And I tried to get across to people, don't see it as a tour. Don't try to make money off the door. If you're making money off the door, you're a fucking moron. You're not making money off the door. Bring merch. But my philosophy was quite simple, and this is why I didn't get upset or get stressed. That was my vacation. Some people will spend money and go to Disney World. Some people will spend money and go to another country. Go to the beach. They'll blow money at Vegas on friggin' gambling and hookers, whatever. It's a vacation. When you go on vacation, you spend money and you buy memories. It's not about the tangible. It's about the experience and the memories. That's what the tour was. I knew that going into it. I am not making money. As close as I can break even, that would be awesome. But I'm not making money. I went because that was my vacation. For a week, I got to spend time with some people I really dig. I got to check out some different clubs. I discovered a bunch of new bands. I met some really chill people. Fucking A. You know, most vacations don't go that well. So that's the way I see it. Did I lose money? Of course. Do I give a fuck? Not really. Because I expected it. Every time I made money, it was like, great. And what did I do with my money? I gave it to the other bands. I gave it, you know, I gave it to my bandmates. Or I put it in my gas tank. I booked the show. I acted as the tour manager. Whoopie-doo, that and a quarter will get me a cup of coffee. But I never took a cent off of that. That wasn't what I wanted. I wanted us all to have a great experience. None of us had ever fucking toured before. And I figured even if we never do it again, we're going to be able to go to our grave saying, fuck yeah, I went on a tour. Fuck yeah, I did it. There's so many bands that didn't. And fuck yeah, I did it. And you can't take away those memories. That was good enough for me.
Outside of being in a band, how do you make a living?
I'm a hooker. Yeah, I fish. No. I'm a disabled vet. So I live on a fixed income. I get my monthly pittance from the government. They broke me, so they throw me a couple of bucks to shut me the fuck up. I also, seasonally, I am a zipline guide. I go up to upstate New York, Hunter Mountain, up in the Catskills. 600 feet above the valley on a cable that stretches between two mountain peaks, about 3/4 mile long. And I'm zipping back and forth on that cable. And I got other people zipping back and forth on that cable. And I'm that motherfucker that stops them at the other end. Because, like I love to tell my guests, there's two ways of stopping on this tour. Me or the mountain. So be nice to me. But yeah, it's a great job. I'm probably one of the oldest fools there. There's a couple others about my age. Most of them are kids in their 20s. Because, I'll tell you, it's a bitch of a job. But I love it. It's fun. The money, it is what it is. But you know what? There ain't nothing on earth like being above the valley in the Catskills between two mountains. I could stop in the middle of that cable, turn around 360 degrees, and I got a full view of the Catskill Mountains. Ain't nobody sitting in a cubicle got that shit. So that's about it. That, and I also have, I used to have a record store, and Splattergod Records. Some people know it, some people don't. But it's a little part of Tampa metal history. And now, you know, I had to close the store because Pam Iorio was not a fan of my store at all. And but I still sell online. So I make a couple bucks here and there. It's nothing great. You know, IRS, leave me the fuck alone. I ain't making no goddamn money. But, you know, it pretty much, that's my concert fund. I sell a CD, I can go to a show. I sell two CDs, I can buy a shirt. I might even get a beer. Woo! But that's about it. I mean, yeah, I'm not rich, but then again, I don't have much in the ways of wants. My kids are grown. I don't have a significant other. I have a cat and two iguanas. They're pretty chill with how I live. I got a nice little one bedroom. Life's good.
What's the biggest crowd you've ever played for?
Probably about 250. That was at that would have been the one of the two shows at Club Venom. Both Club Venom shows, we drew a lot of people. It was funny. The second show we did, the January 10th show, we actually drew more than the crowd at the club show. Rented Lips. Boom. We drew more than the band before us and after us. So that was kind of a proud moment for me. The band before us, I don't even remember. Oh, yes, I do, actually. I think it was Royal Anguish. They weren't too fond of me. Probably had something to do with me chasing the female singer around with my strap on backstage. But, you know, fuck it, you can't take a joke. They were a Christian metal band, so the idea of Jesus chasing her around to me was amusing. Yet they used to come to my store all the time to get changed before they played a show at the Mug, because if anybody remembers the Brass Mug bathrooms, Yeah, my store was a friggin' haven. I mean, everybody, all the bands came there. The big bands came there. But that, and then Dark Faith played after us. It was kind of, to me, that was kind of funny that, you know. But anywho, yeah, I'd say about 250 both times was probably our biggest so far. We have been a couple of times asked to do festivals that have kind of fallen through. I think it's more of planning stages. I do have a friend up in Canada, Gord, who is aka Pile Driver, that is a good friend and also a huge fan of EZT. When he played the Bang Your Head Festival in Germany this year, he actually wore my band shirt on stage, so that just kind of like made me giggle like a schoolgirl. But he has said more than once that he wants us to go ahead and come up. He can't come to America anymore, you know. You gotta love the government. Everybody hates each other now. But he's asked us to come up more than once to open for him at a show or a fest or something. So I'm hoping that happens. Then I'm sure we'll play something a little bigger. I'm also hoping, at very beginning stages, but I'm trying to get us over in Japan, because I actually think our train wreck would be popular there. They tend to dig crazy ass shit. So. And we're about as crazy, you know. My goal is to play Budokan. I just want to do that. I'll even do a Cheap Trick cover. I just want to play Budokan. That place is like legendary. I mean, SOD played their Cheap Trick. EZT needs to now.
What's the smallest crowd you've ever played for?
That would have been our first show, because nobody knew what, you know. Number one was 3 o'clock in the afternoon on the day of a fest.
Nice so, time slot,
yeah, well, I chose that because I didn't want to be a dick and take a good... I didn't want to play like the 8, 9 o'clock slot. Yeah, there have been a lot of people there. But I thought that was an insult to all the other bands that were legitimate bands, had played, had earned. You know, all these bands weren't... These weren't new bands. These were bands that, you know, they paid their dues a little bit. So I didn't want to be a dick about it. So there was about 20, 25 people there. They enjoyed it. They had fun. Hallelujah. Although, I will say, the second show of our tour, now that I think about it, that was a cricket chirping event. I don't know. Maybe, what was there? About 10 people there?
If that.
Yeah. Although the little kid sitting there moshing to EZT and Abortion Twins was kind of fucking cool.
Yeah.
But yeah, now that I remember, yeah, that was, we were playing for the bar staff and the crickets that night. So yeah, but
Gainesville as well was kind of.
Yeah, Gainesville. The general consensus from some of the other bands on the tour was fuck Gainesville. So yeah, I don't think we'll be. It seemed like we did better on the coast as soon as we went. It, with the exception of the Orlando show. You know, and a shout out to you, Richie. Fucking treated us like fucking gods.
Richie rules.
Yeah, the Orlando show was good. I know he promoted it, we promoted it. It was a good turnout, it was a good time. So I think that was the only show. Tallahassee, too, from what I can remember. I was fucking hammered, dude. You know, that was the drunkest I've fucking been in a long time. God damn, I was all kinds of stupid. But it was fun. It's nothing like jumping up and start singing and realizing your band's not behind you playing, it's somebody else. And the cops are outside and everybody's telling you to quit, so I'm singing louder. Yeah, I remember that. But yeah, I was about to say, yeah, the Gainesville, and but still, I think Panama City was worse than Gainesville.
We've already kind of touched on this, but does your band tour, and how many times have you toured? And if not, do you ever plan on touring, or what are your plans for touring?
Yes, we finally toured. It was the Funk as Puck tour, which I wasn't even thinking ahead, but it spells out FAP, so you gotta love that, because that's pretty much what we were doing, just stroking along, hoping for the best. But yeah, it was a one-week excursion through Florida, kind of getting us on, getting the rust out, give us an idea of a little bit of tour experience and everything. My goal is to do a yearly leg of the Funkus Buck Tour, because most people are not independently wealthy, so we can get a week off here, a week off there type thing. So I'm looking at covering different areas of the U.S. at different times and just slowly, you know, and see what happens type thing. But I envision it as being a loose caravan of bands. It doesn't always have to be the same bands, but I just see it as like a loose caravan of bands touring along, playing some shows. It's more of a brotherhood thing than anything else. I just look at a bunch of people going out, having a grand old time, seeing how much chaos we can do, seeing how many times we can avoid the cops and go from there. So I definitely plan on doing another tour. At this point, I'm hoping mid-May, start in New York, work our way to Florida, and see what happens from there.
If you had to give advice to a new band, what advice would you give on being a band?
Don't be dicks. Start a band with people you like. Always remember why you started the band. If you started the band to get rich and get laid, then so be it. Then that's why you started it. But it's not going to work, folks. You might get laid, you might not. Don't know. But you're probably not going to get rich. Don't even, you know, if you're in it just because you're a bunch of brothers and sisters having a good time, you want to have some fun, play some songs, and enjoy life, remember that. Every time you start getting pissed at each other, remember why you started this. Every time you start getting, oh, you fucked it, remember why you started it. Stay grounded. Don't sit there and stress over it. Yeah, if you got a guy that's a total fuck-up, that's one thing. You know, sometimes you got to cut people loose. But if someone just makes a simple mistake, don't stress about it. You know, you can't, you know, remember why you started it. Even these huge bands, they always talk about, they lose sight. It becomes a business. They lose sight of the fact that they were three, four, five guys that went to school together that just wanted to play some music. So that's probably my number one advice. Don't go in looking for money. Just have a good time, and you'll never be disappointed.